analysis of the human genome, all the genes. The genes are the chromosomes. And if you're pregnant, then maybe you get a blood test and there's some marker that may indicate some kind of genetic abnormality, the mom may choose to do an amniocentesis. It's very low risk, maybe 0.5% miscarriage if you do it. But they have to insert a large bore needle in the amnion to extract fluid, which will have fetal cells. You spin down the cells, you put them in culture. Fetal cells are highly mitotic. They'll divide very quickly. So what you want to do is you want to capture the cell when it divides, like in metaphase, anaphase, because that's when the chromosomes are most visible. You can kind of like piece them together. And get pictures, piece them together, and get pictures like this. The human genome is 23 pairs of chromosomes. That's 46, right? But think of them as pairs, because your inheritance is from both of your parents. So you got one set from mom, one set from dad. That's your inheritance. Right here, 23 pairs, okay? Now they're called chromosomes because aren't they very colorful, like chromatic, colorful chromosomes? Sometimes I abbreviate chromosomes XSMS. But the chromosomes is the DNA. It's packaged in a way. The DNA is packaged with some histone proteins. And genes. Genes, DNA, chromosomes. Terms you're familiar with, I hope. Let's talk about sex determination. Of those 23 pairs of chromosomes, one pair are the sex chromosomes. The other 22 you call autosomes. Okay, 22 pairs of autosomes, one pair of sex chromosomes, and that's the one that determines gender, which is why I'm mentioning it, right? So, just talking about the one pair of sex chromosomes, if you had inherited the genotype XX, X from mom, X from dad, you're a female. Okay, that's the genetic pathway. And if you inherit X from mom, Y from dad, that's the male pathway. The Y chromosome, you can learn it has the SRY protein, and it confers the male pathway. Kind of the default is female. So just considering that, egg, sperm, ignoring the other 22 pairs of autosomes, again, XX from both parents, female, XY is the male genotype. Now, to talk about cell division so we can get into reproduction, this is the kind of figure we use for cell division when we teach mitosis in chapter 3 and 4:30. Okay, all cells have this life cycle. And if it's a cell that divides, well, it'll go through some phase of stage of mitosis during its life. Now, not all cells divide. Most do. Epithelial cells are really good at dividing, right? Stem cells divide. Connective tissue cells can divide. Muscle cells don't divide. They're amitotic. Neurons don't divide. They're amitotic. So if you have a spinal cord injury and you damage those cells, you don't get them back and you lose the function, right? That's why paralysis occurs. Same thing in the brain. Some cells divide, and things that happen before a cell divides, I want you to know about. Okay, so for the whole cell life cycle, most of it is interphase, and a very small part is a cell division process, either mitosis or meiosis. But let's talk about some of the things that the cell has to do to get ready to divide that occur in the interphase. Cell membrane, nuclear envelope. Let's say you got, I'll just draw a few chromosomes here. A long one, a short one. Maybe you got the red ones from dad, and you got the other one from mom. One long, one short. From your mom. From your dad. So you say paternal inheritance or maternal inheritance. And that's a cell. Okay? I didn't draw 23 pairs. I basically drew two pairs. Right? You pair them up based on the length of the chromosome. So the long red one is kind of the same chromosome that you got from your mom. That's blue. Okay, I just use colors to make it easy. So in this case, we say 2n equals 4. That's another term that's used in when we talk about cell division. 2n is diploid. Basically, diploid is the full complement of the human genome. Okay. I mean, normally it's 23 pairs of chromosomes. You know, the goal of meiosis, so humans can reproduce, is to reduce it to half, call it N, or haploid. Just call it 23 single chromosomes. Not pairs, half of the set, okay? I mean, that's really the goal for you to understand today, how sperm and egg, those cells develop and then divide, so you get this haploid situation. So that when you fertilize the egg in the uterine tube, you restore the full complement. But backing up, this is normally what you get, 23 chromosomes. Well, I'm just drawing four, okay? So one of the things a cell has to do if it's going to divide, you have to replicate the DNA. So you just double it. That happens in the S phase. It says DNA growth and synthesis. You have DNA replication there. So S phase, during interphase, DNA replication. So what that might look like is, I'm just going to add to my picture here. Just to, you know, show you what I drew. I just replicated it. I made one chromosome, two chromosomes, and they were attached at the central mirror. I replicated it. Okay. So, when they're attached like this, sometimes the term that's used to describe them is a dyad. Seen that term used because they're like there's a pair there. Now these are just copies of each other. They're exact copies. So these two chromosomes, another term that's used, they call them sister chromatids sometimes. It's another term that's used. Copies of each other. Okay. Like this one is like that one there. So now I've replicated. So now what do I call it? It's still diploid, right? But it's diploid replicated. So one of the books I used to teach from would call it 2NR. What does the R stand for?
Replication.
Yeah, replicated, indicating that it's diploid, but now it's replicated. Okay, that happens during the S phase, before cell division even begins. Okay, so technically, how many chromosomes do I got there? Don't I have 8? Yeah. It's diploid replicated is the thing. So I'm going to move on. One of the other things that's important for cell division is something called the centrosome, which is 2 centrioles. A bunch of microtubules coming out of it. Centrosomes are very important in cell division. They attach to the chromosomes and they move them around and divide the DNA in the process of meiosis, which we'll talk about today. Now, the other thing that happens maybe in G2, you're going to duplicate everything else besides the DNA in G2, like all the cytoplasm stuff. But just pay attention to the centrosomes. In late interphase, they'll replicate. Okay, they'll just double it. You get another centrosome. I'll just put that. G2, you know, that's like late interphase-ish. In late interphase, by the time you get there, you'll have DNA replication and you'll have, I'll say replicate centrosome. So let me draw another one. That's basically it. Now the cell is ready to actually enter a cell division phase, either mitosis or meiosis. Since we're talking about reproduction, we'll focus on meiosis. This figure compares the two processes. I'm not going to teach this. Okay, we teach it in 4.3. You can go back and review if you need to. But what you need to know for this unit is this, meiosis. Because the cells that do this in humans are the cells that become sperm and egg. Okay. So the fancy physiology word for sperm and egg, the cells that undergo meiosis, are the spermatogonia. Or the oogonium. Sometimes folks call these the germline cells, the cells that allow us to reproduce. They'll undergo the process of meiosis in the testes or the ovaries, right? So if you look at cells that enter cell division, meiosis, let me zoom in here. They use green and purple. I use red and blue. Again, one color denotes inheritance, that's maternal, the other paternal. They kind of did the same thing I did, 2N equals 4. Is this replicated or not? That's a yes, no question. What do you think?
Yes.
So the goal is meiosis. It'll take place in 2 phases. There's meiosis 1, and then there's meiosis 2. Okay, well, let me pull back a little bit. I say that tetraformed by synapsis of replicated homologous chromosomes. So there's some more terms here. I'll make sure you know what they mean. Well, so what I'm erasing now, you have any questions about the terms that I'm erasing here? The confusing thing about meiosis is all the terms. Well, I guess you could say that for this whole class. The confusing thing is all the terms. Yeah, you're right. Now, what did I call that, dyad or tetrad?
Dyad.
Okay, now, did I say that color was from mom or from dad?
Mom.
I think I said mom. It doesn't really matter, but the point is you got it from one parent. Okay. And, you know, your mom's a human, your dad's a human. Oh, they have the same DNA. You know, whatever chromosome you got from your dad that's your mom, it's they call it homologous. Like, so if I draw the chromosome right next to it, what are homologous chromosomes? It's like if you look at the locations of the genes, say for example, I don't know, hair color. I'm just making it up really, but hypothetically, let's say the locus for the gene for hair color, locus is location. Maybe your dad has straight brown hair. I mean, well anyways, the gene that expresses that trait is at a certain location on a given chromosome, say right there. Now your mom has the same chromosome. Maybe your hair color is different. Maybe it's curly black hair, I don't know. But the location of the gene on the homologous chromosome, the same location. So these are homologous chromosomes, right? So you get it? The same chromosomes from mom, from dad, and homologous chromosomes. Okay.
Okay. Like what you just said for homologous chromosomes.
Yeah.
Okay. So the homologous chromosomes that the okay. So homo means same, but does that have something to do with the physical characteristics of a person?
No, just the gene for hair color. Yeah, is homologous.
Oh, is that like just is hair color one of the examples? Or
yeah, just an example. Yeah, I mean, it could be gene for anything. The point is, you get a gene from mom and a gene from dad that do the same thing, express hair color. Okay. I just want you to know what's meant by homologous. You have a set from mom and a set from dad, and they're the same. And there's a part in cell division where the same chromosomes, the homologous chromosomes, they find each other. Okay. So differentiate between what a homologous chromosome is, the red to the blue, versus the blue to the blue. What did I say about the blue to the blue? When DNA replicates, the blue to the, they're the same chromosome. It's a copy, okay? But these are homologous, all right? That's the subtle difference there. So you have four chromosomes, right? The two blues are copies. We call them sister chromatids. The two reds are copies. We call them sister chromatids. But the red to the blue are homologous chromosomes. And one thing that's good for biology and cell division is you want genetic variation in the offspring. And so that happens here in meiosis. Yeah, was there a question?
Yeah.
No, she was first. I'll ask you next. Yeah, Victoria?
I was thinking about are there
something that
you can change the color of the eyes?
Okay, that's interesting.
Can they change the DNA?
Yeah.
Okay,
alright. Don't introduce cool stuff because I have a hard enough time getting students to understand this. Do you guys understand between what a copy is and what a homologous chromosome is?
Yes.
Okay, Felicia? Yeah, homologous.
Okay, so, could it be like your eye color? Or
yeah, it could be eye color. It could be anything.
Oh.
Yeah. What color are your dad's eyes? Oh, brown. Okay. Brown eye. Okay. What on his copy? What's it going to be gene for? Oh, the same color. All right. Now the homologous chromosome. Maybe your mom has blue eyes. So that's there. But on the copy, what's it going to be? Oh, it's going to be blue eyes too. It's the same gene. So copy versus homolog.
Oh.
We're gonna move on.
Okay,
good. You see how it says tetrad formation? Write that down. Tetrad formation. formation occurs as a result of synapses. In biology 430, you studied what a synapse is, the junction between an axon terminal and another cell, a connection. Here, in the spirit of that word, the homologous chromosomes are coming to, they're zippering up. They're getting in close proximity to each other, just like here. They're getting buddy-buddy, the long one and the short one. And that allows for, you know, crossover events to occur. I'll talk about that. You want to mix the DNA up. It could be that maybe as a result of synapses, we'll make it something like this. Parts switch because they get close to each other. So you get some genetic variability. Well, the main thing I want to talk about is just what happens in meiosis one. Look how they separate the DNA. At the end of meiosis one, one cell became two. Look how you divided the DNA. You separated the homologous chromosomes, but the sister chromatids stayed attached to each other. So in meiosis one, one cell becomes two. And when the one cell becomes two, in the two cells, you separate homologous chromosomes. And in each cell, you can kind of see what they have there. Well, let me draw an example. I have two cells here. Something like that. They basically say, this is what you have. What are each of these X's called again? Dyad or tetrad?
Dyad,
your sister chromatids to each other. Here's a question. When you get to this point here, when you have two cells and you've separated the homologous chromosomes, is it haploid or diploid? It is haploid, okay? This cell is haploid. Haploid means half the DNA, not half a set. However, because sister chromatids still remain together, and what are sister chromatids? They're copies. This half a set is replicated. So I put a little R there. Haploid, replicated. Haploid, I'll write it out. Now, in each of these cells, daughter cells, I just drew two dyads. But in a human cell, it's not really just two. It's really 23, okay? So know that. 23 dyads, 23 dyads. I would write it down. Okay, this is meiosis one. You have to go through another phase of cell division to separate the replicated chromosomes. And that's meiosis two. See that there? This is meiosis, the start of meiosis two, where two cells become four. what you're going to do now is you're going to separate the sister chromatids, okay, because they're just replicated. You separate those in each of the cells. There's no further chromosomal replication. Sister chromatids separate during anaphase 2. So basically that's what I'm saying. Separate sister chromatids. So I'm going to draw four cells. At the end of meiosis 2, each of these cells will have basically half of this. So it looks like this. So this cell will have that, that, so this is haploid. It's not replicated in each cell. We just call it, you know, N. Haploid. That's it. Now, I just drew two chromosomes in each cell, but really, what is it? It's not two. It's 23 in a human cell, right? 23 dyads? 23 dyads? That's what I'm going for here. In a human cell, because we're humans, right? 23 single chromosomes. They're not replicated. 23 single chromosomes per cell. In that one, in that one, in that one, in that one. And that's half a set. The other half comes from the egg, if you're a sperm, or vice versa. So what we're going to do is understand meiosis and apply it to the ovary, okay? Because today is female reprophysiology. But before I do that, I actually have to teach meiosis 1 and meiosis 2. You're like, have you been doing that? Not really. I've just been teaching what the words mean. Tetrad, dyad, homologous, sister chromatid, all that stuff. But I think it's good for students to know the basic phases of meiosis 1 and meiosis 2, like that. Okay. It's taught in any basic bio class, but to make sure we're all on the same page, I'll go through it. Okay, and today's lab activity is I'll give you a chance to kind of model out all these different phases. I think it's very important to do. The questions I get asked about meiosis, I realize students need a hands-on practice just to get it down okay. And I had my daughter cut a bunch of little pipe cleaners that'll symbolize chromosomes. But now in the lecture, let me just kind of go through the different phases. I mean, we're starting with prophase one, that's meiosis, but preceding meiosis, you have interphase. Now, we just did this. You couldn't have forgotten already. What replicates in S? DNA. Yeah. That already happens, right? The late interphase. Okay, G2. What replicates there? Centrism. Go look up centrosome. It's a complicated made out of centrioles and microtubules. But you need this. The centrosome is key to look at. So when you enter meiosis, one, first phase, you're going to start with prophase one. So the DNA has already replicated. So here's a multiple choice question. What's the correct ploidy? That's a term I've seen before. I tend to use a ploidy. Is it 2N? Is it 2NR? Is it NR? Is it N? I ask this all the time in this year. when you enter prophase one, which of these four is it? Two and R. You're diploid, and you've already replicated. Okay. So that's important to note. Cell is diploid replicated to NR. Here you see, I'll kind of zoom in a little bit, you get the tetrad formation. The homologous chromosomes, their synapses, and they get close to each other, forming a tetrad. So that's shown there, our 2N equals 4 here, right? Maternal, paternal, the green and the purple, the homologous chromosomes get close to each other in synapses. So that's what I'll write. Synapsis occurs. Tetransform. Tetra implies what number?
Four.
So we have four chromosomes there, right? They're homologous chromosomes. So they show in our illustration two tetrads form. You see that? Here's a tetrad. Here's another tetrad. But again, always keep this in mind. In humans, how many tetrads are there? 23. Yeah. 23 tetrads is diploid replicated. Okay. The other thing that's important to know here is, do you see the centrosomes? You can't see because it's not an animation. Usually, they start off close together, and then they kind of spread apart. The centrosomes go to the opposite end of the cell in prophase. It's like maybe the centrosomes have duplicated, and they start to move one end, move to the other end. Okay. So I'm writing centrosomes move to the opposite ends of the cell. The other thing you should note that's illustrated there in prophase one, that is, the nuclear envelope, it starts to break down. It says nuclear envelope fragments late in prophase one. It just breaks down. Because you're going to move the chromosomes around, you've got to get rid of the envelope that contains them. Nuclear envelope breaks down. Okay, I wanted to show you, as a result of synapses tetransform, why do you want that? Because you want to allow a chance for the homologous chromosomes to make switches. Okay, they call them genetic recombination or crossover events. Let me show you a slide on that. I'm going to fast forward here. You'll notice I have pictures of animations. My iPad won't play them. But what I did was I put these animations on a PowerPoint, and I made the PowerPoint available. I usually don't. I usually just give you the PDF. But if you have PowerPoint and you want to download the PowerPoint file, it'll allow you to play the animation so you can kind of see it better, basically. Well, anyways, the idea about synapses, it allows genetic recombination events to occur. Okay. Synapsis allows genetic recombination events call them crossover events. Let me show you a picture of that. So this is going on in your gonads. You inherited chromosomes from your mom and your dad, and those chromosomes are undergoing mix-ups, crossover events. Here's a tetrad, okay? You see the paternal, maternal inheritance, and they give you two locations for, one for hair color, one for eye color, those genes, okay? And what happens is, because they're in close proximity to each other during synapsis, when you get the tetrads to form, they cross over at the chiasm right here. And as a result, it gets mixed up like this. And this increases the genetic variability. And that's really the goal. The goal is the resulting gametes. Have increased genetic variability. So if you finish this meiosis, each gamete would have one of these chromosomes, and some of them are a mix-up. Let me remember what I have on the slide there. At the conclusion of meiosis, each haploid gamete has one of four chromosomes shown. Two of the chromosomes, right, are recombinant. They are a patchwork of the parental chromosomes. Crossover events increase genetic variability of gametes. We have, on average, maybe this happening one per tetrad, something like that, okay? But remember, you have about 23 tetrads in each dividing cell. So this occurs during prophase one, because that's when the tetrads form. I just want to go back to that slide I was on, this one. After prophase one, this occurs, then you get metaphase one, where the homologous chromosomes are lining up side by side at the equator. Phase one, homologous chromosomes align at equator. Another thing that increases genetic variability. I mean, what's the order here? Now, I see this pair lining up, and I see this pair. There's two lining up. But really, how many are going to line up top to bottom? 23, right? And those 23, is there a rhyme or reason to it? It's like, oh, okay, I'm chromosome number 5. Oh, if he goes there, I'm chromosome number 6. I got to go next. They're not dependent on each other. They assort at the equator independent from each other, and they call that independent assortment. They assort independently. That's the other thing I want you to know from metaphase one. Okay, this independent assortment. I have some slides in here about that here. Independent assortment of chromosomes. Right. Independent assortment of chromosomes. It's random, basically. And if it's a random event in every cell that's doing this, you're going to increase the genetic variability. Think of an example where, if you can't see the back there, just these two. They just do like three tetrads lining up. Really, it's 23. But look at this. Purple, purple, purple. Okay, that's random. These assort independently. What if it's purple, green, purple on this side. And on the other side, it's green, 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 purple, green. Well, if you finish the whole process, meiosis one, meiosis two, the resulting gametes look like this. This set of four looks different from that set of four because of this independent assortment during metaphase one. The other permutations, I guess you could have, if it's only three, but really it's 23, is green, purple, purple on this side, or on this one it's purple, purple, green, okay? So those are all the permutations just for three chromosomes. So imagine it for, you know, 23. You know, you may have a sibling that doesn't look anything like you. Like, do we have the same parents? You know, and, well, there's a lot of genetic variability that happens, so anything's possible. Crossover events, you got independent assortment, both increase genetic variability. I'd write it again, just for emphasis, if you're wondering why I mentioned it. Increase genetic variability. The other thing to note for metaphase one before I move on, do you see how the centrosomes on either side and all the microtubules that they've attached to the centromere to move them at the metaphase plate or at the equator as I called it? Okay, I don't know if you knew that. Write it down if you forgot that for basic bio. It's like chromosomes, all these things are coming out of it. The microtubule, it kind of grabs onto the chromosome at the centromere and moves it around. Okay? So that's a microtubule. They attach to centromere. Remember, this thing is a centrosome. Another thing I mentioned was there's no nuclear envelope. It's completely gone. And notice the appearance of all the chromosomes aligned here. They call this thing a spindle. It looks like a spindle. When the nuclear envelope's gone, they're all aligned. Okay, spindle apparatus, spindle. If you ever see that term, it's referring to the appearance of how the chromosomes look with the centrosomes on either side, quote unquote. Spindle apparatus. Kind of see that in metaphase and anaphase too. So what happens in anaphase one, you separate, you're physically separating the homologous chromosomes. They're kind of all together. And you're separating the tetrads basically. Anaphase one. Separate homologous chromosomes. One thing to note is that kind of V, when you pull at the middle, it kind of makes the chromosome look like a V, a sideways V. If you pull this chromosome this way, you kind of like make it appear like that. Well, anyways, I'm mentioning this because when you model it in your lab activity today, when you get to anaphase, I want to see this effect. When you separate them. Yeah, sure, go ahead. That's exactly what's happening, yes. Because that one cell is going to divide, and you want half of this in one cell and half of it in another cell, and that's where we'll go with this. So when you get to telophase, you can start to pinch off the one cell so it becomes two. Okay? So this is telophase one. Yeah, it will. When we get to telophase one, it will be haploid.
Oh, I mean, that's the goal of telophase one, is to become a haploid so it can start dividing.
Yes.
Okay.
The goal of telophase one is you will be haploid, but you're still replicated. Because remember, what comes after mouse is one?
Mouse is two.
Mouse is two, yeah, there you go.
Okay.
So telophase one is the end of mouse is one, yeah.
Okay, and also earlier you said something about interphase. Interphase is not included in meiosis, right?
No. No. It goes interphase, then cell division, then meiosis.
Okay, so the interphase is getting ready for meiosis one.
Basically, I think you can think of it that way. That's why I presented it today. Interphase is basically the life cycle of a cell, just not the part where it divides. So we're talking about just the part where it divides. And in telophase one, look what's happening. You finish separating the DNA. The DNA had to really coil up so you could move it safely. But when you finally get to telophase, it can kind of uncoil, so to speak. And you can reform the nuclear envelope. Because you finish dividing the DNA, and the cell membrane itself, it starts to pinch off. You can kind of see that in this illustration. Sometimes equally, sometimes unequally, you basically have a thing called cytokinesis. Cytokinesis is a division of the cytoplasm. That little invagination of the cell membrane as evidence of cytokinesis. They call it cleavage furrow here. The end result is you're going to have two cells that are haploid replicated. After it pinches off, each daughter cell. We said that each cell will have 23 dyads, basically. That's haploid replicated. 23 dyads. And I always put the 23 because the illustrations never show that. But now I want you to remember what's in a human cell. Okay, let me find my slide on meiosis two and move on here. Right here. So now there's not a lot of time between meiosis one and meiosis two. And so when you start meiosis two along the same progression, now we have two cells that will become four. And we start with prophase two. I won't give you any new notes. Well, I should give you some notes. I mean, you have the nuclear envelope. Do you want it there, or do you want to break it down?
Break it down.
You do want to break it down. Yeah. So that does occur in prophase too as well. So I'm writing break down nuclear envelope. Okay, let's go to metaphase 2. When you get to metaphase 2, now the chromosomes, the dyads, will align single file at the equator. Okay? That'll allow you to then separate the sister chromatids. So I'll write dyads align single file at the equator. Then anaphase 2, you separate the sister chromatids. So that in telophase 2 and then cytokinesis, it looks the same thing. You reform the nuclear envelope, you're done dividing the DNA. You write that down. Telophase 2, along with the cytokinesis, reform nuclear envelope. Four resulting gametes will be haploid, not replicated. Just 23 single chromosomes, not pairs. Okay. 23 single chromosomes. Again, we're only talking about sperm or egg, right? Fertilization will restore the full complement. And I'll give you a chance to practice the basic phases of meiosis today. Try to go a little bit fast. Sorry if I'm cutting some of you off in your questions, but I haven't even got to what I really want to get to yet. But when you practice meiosis today, or if I on a quiz I ask you a phase of meiosis, ask yourself this: do you see one cell becoming two? Usually that means I'm quizzing you something on meiosis one, right? But if you see two cells and it's becoming four or almost four, you're somewhere in meiosis two. Why don't I stop talking just for a minute? Look at these pictures. I've mixed them up, numbered them. Can you guess the phase of meiosis 1 or meiosis 2 for each of these? Go ahead, take a few minutes. Do it now, okay? It's gonna warm you up, and I'll check in just a minute. Go ahead and talk amongst yourselves, and commit yourself to answer 1 to 8. I wanna see if you can get this now.
can understand the metaphase, baby.
Let's see how you did. What do you see there? I see one cell, it's almost becoming two, starting to pinch off. You're at the end of meiosis one, this is telophase one. I see two cells, and these dyads are lining up. This is metaphase two. I see almost four cells. You're at the end of meiosis two, this is telophase two. Okay, this is one cell. I see the tetrads aligning at the equator, metaphase one. Okay, you're separating the homologous chromosomes here. This is anaphase one. Prophase one, okay. This looks like you're at two cells. This is prophase two. And this one, you're separating the sister chromatids, two cells. And so this is anaphase two. Okay, and you'll have a chance to do this again in lab. I'll check you guys off. Yeah. And we do have this in model form. It's over there. This is over there. Can't see it for sitting in the back, but I could ask you these kinds of things on the lab practical too, as well as lecture, and I kind of just keyed it out for you there. What they show you is, let me see if you see what I see. Okay. How many centrosomes do you see here? First of all, do you see it? What color is it?
Yellow.
See the yellow?
Yeah.
How many are there? One or two?
One, two?
This is one centrosome interphase. Okay, now you got it to the prophase. How many do you see? How many centrosomes? Yeah, now you see two. And do you see how they're close together? Just look at the centrosomes. Here, here. Are you getting closer together, or are they moving apart? Are they moving? That's kind of what they're trying to show you, right? There's like an earlier part of prophase and later, and they do show you some crossover events there. They don't show you all the phases. They show you some of them. Okay, metaphase one, anaphase one, telophase one. Here's anaphase two. And look at this, in anaphase one, do you see that chromosome there? It's a double, right? Do you see that one there? Is that a double or a single?
Single.
It's a single because you're separating the copies. Okay. Here you're separating the homologous chromosomes. Now it's mostly red. Why is that blue there? And why is that red there? What happened? I heard it. Yeah, you crossover event. You had a genetic recombination in prophase one. So you know a lot of things are shown nicely on that set. Now what we have to do is apply this to the ovarian cycle. I'll do male tomorrow.
Okay, here's the ovary, and inside there of the follicles is the egg, the oocyte, and meiosis is occurring. Okay, and I kind of want to like mention that. Basically, I want to tie the ovarian cycle to meiosis. Okay, that's what we want to do. And we start with the follicle phase. The follicle phase in the menstrual cycle. So the ovary, sexually mature female. Well, let's just say ovary for now. Ovary. Let's back up a little bit. Ovary, meiosis. On one side of the board, on the other side of the board, just to kind of make it a little clearer here. And what I want you to know is that this is showing you primordial and primary follicles. It starts with primordial here. There's a primary there. But the primordial follicles, I said in a previous lecture that the primordial follicles form somewhere around the 7th month of pregnancy. That's what I'm writing. The primordial follicles form at the 7th month of pregnancy. And you might have something like 1 to 2 million of these primordial follicles with an oocyte inside. And so meiosis, what's happening in these oocytes is you're pretty much in a prophase 1 arrest. And then the female is born, okay? Then you reach puberty at about age 12. About 12.5 years of age, puberty, okay? Maybe you're down to like 400,000 of the primordial follicles. But still, in those oocytes, it's prophase 1 arrest. And you call the egg a primary oocyte because it's going to start, it's in meiosis 1. So if you're in meiosis 1, the oocyte is a primary oocyte. If you're in meiosis 2, later on, we'll call it a secondary oocyte. So meiosis 1, primary. In that cell, how many tetrads would there be? 23. It's like I only gave that one number, right? Can't miss that question. So that's what's there. Would you describe the primordial follicle, based on our discussion of it before, as mature or immature? Immature. But what I mean by that, for those of you who are like, what does he mean by maturity? Is it secreting the sex hormones? And the answer is no for this one. Remember, a primordial follicle, look at the picture, it's the oocyte surrounded by squamous cells, and those cells don't really do anything. Okay, they're hormonally inactive. What happens is, in a sexually mature female, you will select a cohort of 20 primordial follicles to undergo further maturation. So we just listed on the board. each menstrual cycle about 20 follicles are selected to undergo further maturation. Menstrual means month. So divide that month up into 4 weeks. The first couple of weeks, it's called the follicular phase, okay? So this follicle phase, choose your 20. And maybe they'll get out of the primordial and they'll progress to primary follicle. I would also describe primary follicle as immature. It's not really secreting any of the hormones that you need, but at least now you're starting to develop the follicle cells. They're not squamous anymore, they're cuboidal. Okay, and you see the oocyte inside. It's still in prophase one arrest. So the primary oocyte still in prophase one arrest. These will develop further, and you know, FSH is responsible for this largely. Follicle stimulating hormone develops the follicles. Sure. Meiosis unless sperm gets there. Sperm never gets there, never finishes. Why does it need to, right? So that's where we're going. Good point. So for now, we're just going to prophase one arrest. And, there's more maturity that happens. FSH will make the primary follicle become secondary. Now, there's different phases of secondary. This is like secondary early. There's also secondary late, but let's just call it all secondary. I would say the structures to note on a more mature follicle is that it's got this ZP and the theca. Theca folliculi and the zona pellucida. Those are the structures you start to notice more on these more mature follicles that will secrete the sex hormones. Okay, so the zona pellucida. Let me start up here. Let me refer to more. Things to note about the secondary follicle. Now, a primary follicle, how many follicle cell layers were there? Just one. Now, when they start to proliferate, that's secondary. We have many layers, and we call them granulosa cells. Now, that's not on here, but you should note that. Secondary follicles have many layers of granulosa cells. And outside of the granulosa cells, you have theca. So on this picture here, I see some granulosa cells, and then outside of that, theca. What I had said in a previous lecture was theca will secrete androstenedione. Under the influence of FSH, this androstenedione, which is actually a male hormone, it's converted to a female hormone. You transfer androstenedione to the granulosa cells, and under the influence of FSH, you increase the aromatase activity that converts it to estrone. So I'll just write androstenedione estrone, and aromatase facilitates that conversion to get your estrogen. Okay. And this process is under the influence of follicle stimulating hormone in the sexually mature female. So I'll just put a big bracket and put it. It's under FSH influence. But when we say sex hormones, which one is it of all these words? Estrone. Estrogen is a class of hormones. Estrone is one of them. Okay? So if you just said estrogen, I'm fine with that. The ZP, the zona pellucida, is like an eggshell around the primary oocyte. There's proteins there that can interact with sperm. I'll talk about that when I get to development, but I would at least note zona pellucida is noticeable. It's not part of the oocyte. It surrounds it. Like an egg, it's our eggshell. Okay. Alright, so each cycle, you're selecting 20. So you've got about 20 of these that are making it this far, whether it be secondary or late secondary. I think that's my next slide. There's a later secondary. Figa, ZP, start to see some fluid around the follicle there. So I put 20 here. You got about 20 secondary follicles, and they're secreting estrogen. That makes a female, right? You got the hormones. And what happens is only one will achieve full maturation. One of the 20 secondary follicles is quote unquote selected to undergo further maturation. Probably the one with the most FSH receptors. Okay? So what happens is these 20 follicles, they're pretty much all under prophase 1 arrest. Prophase 1 arrest. The one that achieves dominance will go on to become a graafian follicle. That one will complete meiosis 1. None of the others. The other 19 don't do that. The one follicle that achieve dominance what reaches graafian stage, right? Well, anyways, on the meiosis side of the board, I want you to note the one that achieves dominance will complete meiosis 1. Okay. Primary oocyte completes meiosis 1. So you go through prophase 1, anaphase 1, you know, telophase 1, and you're going to eject the cell divides, but it's not an equal division. You're going to eject what's called a polar body. Okay, it's going to contain half the DNA, 23 dyads. So it looks something like this. This kind of unequal division of the cytoplasm, so that it's like you're putting all of the cytoplasm in one cell. To complete meiosis 1. The polar body is getting nothing. got the DNA, but it's got no cytoplasm. First polar body. Oops. Well, I said cell, it's not a cell, it's a body. First polar body. It's just a cell that got nothing in the division. Because when you ovulate, you want to ovulate the egg that has all the cytoplasm so it can survive in the uterine tube to await fertilization. Okay, so put all the cytoplasm in what's going to be ovulated. Forget about the polar body. Students always ask me, what happens to them? Where does it go? I don't know. It's not important. What's important in this unit is reproduction. The oocyte that's ovulated is important. It gets all the cytoplasm. And that's not shown here. That's why I kind of like to draw that. So the one that achieved dominance finishes meiosis one. What comes after meiosis one? Meiosis two. And as the point was brought up by Felicia, do you want it to finish meiosis two? Well, yeah, but only if sperm is there. So right now, you don't want it to finish. Okay. So here's a graphene follicle. Assume it's completed meiosis one. So I'll just put graphene. I've been calling it graphene follicle in your studies. People call it different things. They call it the most mature follicle. They call it vesicular follicle, tertiary follicle. So I do see other names. I'm sticking with graphene. Okay. And you finished meiosis one. Done. Eject polar body. Okay. 23 dyads in this cell, 23 dyads in that one. And what did we say that was? Was that haploid or diploid? The 23 dyad thing. Haploid. It was haploid. Put that in on the board. And the dyad. Is that haploid replicated or not?
Yes.
Yeah, it's replicated. NR. So each of these cells, this cell and this cell, they're haploid replicated. We just call this cell that got no cytoplasm the polar body. Now this cell, you're done with meiosis one. We've been calling it primary oocyte. But now that you're done with meiosis one, you're going to call it secondary oocyte now. Alright, so I'm going to erase this. Question for you. How many reached this stage?
One.
One, typically. Now I'm talking about the one. And it has a secondary oocyte. Inside that cell, you're going through meiosis two, but you don't finish. You get arrested somewhere in metaphase two, anaphase two. I'm going to just pick one. How about anaphase two? If you see somewhere else, I say, or someone else that says metaphase 2MS, don't get hung up about that. Okay. The point is, you didn't finish. All right. So this is the one that will ovulate. So what happens is, your egg, right there, it's going to have to break off the wall. It's going to have to bust through the wall and bust out of the ovary on day 14. It's ovulation. So ovulation pretty much marks the end of the follicular phase. Right. Here's a picture of it there. Here's another real picture of it that was circulated by a colleague. I thought it was cool. There's a follicle. There's the egg busted out of there. They happened to have it open, and it happened to be happening in front of the surgeon's eyes, and they took pictures of it. I thought that was pretty cool to see for real. Okay, ovulation. If we want to put a big line, because ovulation of the follicle phase. Still, anaphase II arrest, okay? I'm not gonna touch that. You're still in anaphase II arrest. So after ovulation, there's something called the luteal phase in the ovary. The luteal phase we have a Graafian follicle. The Graafian follicle is the follicle with the egg inside. But ovulation, the secondary oocyte is ovulated to the uterine tube. It's gone. It's gone. Goes to uterine tube. Awaits fertilization. Fertilization never occurs, the mucosa of the oviduct of the uterine tube can just engulf it. Okay. But what's left behind? You have a ruptured follicle. A ruptured follicle will bleed after ovulation. They call it a bleeding body or corpus hemorrhagicum. Hemorrhage is bleeding, so that's a fancy word of saying bleeding body. But that ruptured follicle will actually become an endocrine structure. It'll turn into a yellow body. Corpus luteum. Yellow because probably full of cholesterol, and cholesterol is like, you make the sex hormones out of it. The one you're going to get now out of the corpus luteum is progesterone, okay? But for now, when you get the development of this yellow body, you call it the luteal phase. I mean, roughly the second 2 weeks of your 28-day cycle, okay? So up to this point, the follicular phase, the first couple of weeks, ovulation day 14, right, that was on today's quiz. Then the second 2 weeks, luteal phase. Corpus luteum means you're in the luteal phase. So let me write that on the top of the board. Phase means that structure is secreting progesterone, mostly. The follicle secreted primarily estrogen. That caused the proliferative phase in the uterine cycle. Progesterone targets the uterus and it causes the secretory phase. Like gestation means pregnancy. Pro means before pregnancy. I mean, this is what you want right before pregnancy. Because if you conceived, if you got pregnant, what day did it happen?
14.
Day 14. Implantation will occur roughly a week later during this time. Okay. So this is an important hormone to get it ready for implantation. It's basically, over here, in terms of meiosis, this is in the uterine tube. Now we have this body here. We have to go through two scenarios, pregnant or not pregnant. Okay. Let's say not. No sperm ever come. You just never get out of phase two. You don't finish, there's no need to. That goes away in the uterine tube, no sperm or eye. Okay, you don't get pregnant. This has a lifespan of a couple of weeks, and then it dies and becomes corpus albicans. Okay, and you can start over. You have menses and you'll start over. The scenario where you're pregnant, sperm arrives, fertilization occurs, okay, and you'll get a developing embryo. Finish meiosis 2. Okay, when you finish meiosis 2, when the sperm arrives, you eject a second polar body. See if I can give you a visual on this. So the sperm got there, and the sperm DNA is now inside the fertilized egg. You finish meiosis 2, eject that, call it a second polar body. What's in it? 23 single chromosomes. Get rid of it. You only want each of these things that I drew really has 23 single chromosomes. Okay? The thing you're rejecting has 23 single chromosomes in it from the mom. Get rid of it. Here's the other 23. You want those 23 single chromosomes to merge with dad, right? The father. His 23 chromosomes. To restore the full complement, and you reject the second polar body. Where's the first polar body? I guess I should draw it too. I'll just draw another thing there with, you know, the 23 dyads in it, and I don't know. The polar bodies are not important. What's important is what's happening with the fertilization process here. If that happens, a question for you. Well, I don't know if it's a question. Let me just tell you. If fertilization occurs, you want the corpus luteum to stay there. You don't want it to die. What does the corpus luteum do? What does it secrete? Progesterone. What does progesterone do? It gets you to the secretory phase. That'll support the pregnancy. So as long as progesterone is there because the corpus luteum is there, the corpus luteum of pregnancy, this will stick around until the placenta comes. You'll miss your period, right? Because it'll keep secreting progesterone to support implantation for the pregnancy. Here's a picture of corpus luteum. This is what I took last year from our collection. This is the picture of corpus luteum from the book. This is the luteal phase. It's the second couple of weeks. That's if you're pregnant. It'll stay there. If you're not pregnant, it dies and becomes what? Corpus albicans. Okay. Yeah, let's take a break.
Okay.
I can answer a question individually, but let me dismiss people for break in and I'll help you out. And when we come back, we've got one more slide to cover.